This video is an example of the paired t-test. An SAT prep course claims to increase student scores by more than 60 points on average. To test this claim, 9 students who have previously taken the SAT are randomly chosen to take the prep course. Their SAT scores before and after completing the prep course are listed in the following table. Test the claim at the 0.02 level of significance, assuming that the population distribution of the paired differences is approximately normal. Let scores before completing the prep course be population 1, and let scores after completing the prep course be population 2. For the paired t-test, to get this in the TI-84 calculator, I'm going to have to reduce this to a single sample t-test using subtraction, as there is no dedicated paired t-test built into this calculator. It's much easier to do it this way than to find all of the pieces by hand, but the calculator can help you find some of those pieces by hand if you wanted to do it that way. I'm going to use the p-value method, and I'm going to use the calculator to find the critical value and use the critical value method also. Because this level of significance of 0.02 is not one that I can find in the t-table that I have with this particular textbook. So I have the before prep course, and that's population 1. And the after, which will be population 2. And the trickiest part, I think, for the paired t-test is to figure out the direction of the alternative, because how you subtract, while it's not going to make a difference if you subtract correctly with respect to the direction of your alternative, if you don't keep track of that consistency, you're going to get the wrong conclusion. So what we want for this problem is we want the after to be greater than the before by more than 60 points. Okay, so the overall mean for the after I can denote as mu sub 2. And the overall population mean for the before I can denote as mu sub 1. So in terms of subtraction, what I want is I want the before, I'm sorry, the after, okay, this is after taking the prep course, minus the before. We want this difference to be greater than 60, right? That's what they're saying in this problem, or what is claimed by this SAT prep company. Now, in the paired t-test, we denote this difference as mu sub d. But I think it's important to see it this way first, so that you know what order of subtraction you're going to do. All right, so because this doesn't contain the case of equality, this is going to be my alternative. So my alternative in this problem is that mu sub d will be greater than 60. So this forces the null to be mu sub d either less than or equal to 60, depending on the textbook you're using, or if you're using a textbook that uses the straight equality in the null, will just be equal to 60. Okay, so if this were a situation where there'd be a difference versus no difference, then I would have equal versus not equal, and this side would be 0. Okay, so it's common to see that type of problem for the paired t-test, a difference versus no difference. And in that case, this side will be 0. But here they want this difference to be more than 60. But what is it they want to be more than 60? They want the after minus the before to be more than 60. So this tells me how I'm going to subtract. So before recording, I went ahead and put the values into my calculator. And I apologize, this is a little dim. Let me do this. All right. So going to my edit screen, I have in list one my before, and in list two I have my after. So I can go up to my third list, press enter, and see how my cursor is down below the screen. I've already decided how I want the subtraction to go. I want the after minus the before. So I'm going to tell the calculator to take all of the values in list two and subtract from that all of the values in list one. So here I have all of my differences. This is what I'm going to run a single sample t-test on. The test statistic for the paired t-test, this test statistic is d bar, the sample mean of the differences, minus mu sub d, okay, the claimed difference or the hypothesized difference. Again, for a lot of the problems you'll run across, that will be zero, over the standard deviation of the differences over square root of n, where n is the number of pairs. Okay, so I have 9 pairs of data here. Okay, so you can think of these as ordered pairs. This 1340 goes with this 1340. This 1090 goes with this 1220. Okay, so the order matters here. You don't want to mix these up when you're inputting them into the calculator. So if you wanted to do this by hand, you would still want to do these pieces, the subtraction to get the differences in list three. Because if you go back to your stat menu and run one variable statistics on list three, making sure your frequency list is blank because we're not finding a weighted mean here, this X bar will be your D bar. And this S sub X will be your S sub D. So in other words, for list three, we've created a new sample. So you could go ahead and find the pieces you need off of this third list using your one variable statistics. Okay, that is certainly one way to do it. It's a lot quicker than finding all of these pieces by hand. But to be even more quick about this, I'm going to go ahead and use the single sample t-test, because this test reduces to a single sample t-test through subtraction. So I'm going to my stat menu, arrowing over to tests, and option two is the t-test. I either have the summary statistics or I have the data in a list. I could have copied the summary statistics from my one variable statistics screen, but to be quick about it, I'm going to run this hypothesis test off of the new data that I created in list three. This mu sub zero is the hypothesized or claimed difference, and I want that to be 60. And my data is in list three. I can go ahead and change that if I want, leaving this frequency alone. Here I can change my direction of alternative. I've determined through the wording of this problem, this is an upper-tailed test, and I was consistent with that with my subtraction. Okay, if I wanted to make this a lower-tailed test, I could have. I would have to make this negative 60, and I would have to subtract in the other direction. Okay, but I think recognizing that we want the after to be greater than the before by more than 60, it lends itself better to an upper tail test with the wording of the problem. Now I'm going to go down and calculate My test statistic is 1.788. Okay, you would get the same thing if you had put in these pieces and calculated this by hand. And I can see that my corresponding p-value is 0.066. Already looking at this p-value, I know that I'm going to fail to reject at a level of significance of 0.02 because this p-value is greater than 0.02. So I have my p-value, 0.066, my stated alpha level of 0.02. This is greater than the level of significance, so I know my decision is to fail to reject. Okay, so I'm failing to reject the null. So what does the null mean? Okay, well, the null statement here is that there's really no change, that this average distance is equal to 60. It's possible it could be less than 60. One way to look at that would be to look at the corresponding confidence interval. But what the claim is saying is the claim is that those who complete the prep course have on average an increase of more than 60. So this is the claim right here. The claim in this case is the alternative. So if we fail to reject the null, okay, the null is the winner here. Okay, we are not in support of the claim. So to state this for your homework, you would say there is insufficient evidence to support the claim that the scores before completing the prep course are, There is insufficient evidence to support the claim that the students' scores increase by more than 60 points. So if this were advertised and this claim is not supported, it is possible that you or your parents are wasting your money on this. Okay, because clearly, given this sample of 9 and this p-value and level of significance, this claim is not supported. Now, to use the critical value method, you want to draw your area of rejection. The t-distribution is bell-shaped, and the direction of the alternative is greater than. So I know this is an upper-tailed test. I don't have to divide alpha in 2 because I have a single-tailed test. I want 0.02 amount of area. The mean for the t-distribution is 0. I expect this critical value, this t-value here, to be positive. Like the inverse normal on most TI-84s, or the older TI-84s, anyway, the required input is a cumulative area. Now, if your calculator has an inverse normal distribution, you're going to have to recognize the fact that you could put in 0.02 as your input, but it's going to give the negative or the symmetric value here, and you just take the positive one. Or you can recognize the fact that if this is 0.02 for this area, there's 0.98 area further to the left. So I'm going to go ahead and go to my inverse normal distribution. Okay, option 4. It expects this cumulative area. Okay, cumulative meaning the total amount of area to the left of that critical value. And my degrees of freedom, again, is the number of pairs minus 1. So my degrees of freedom is 8. And I get 2.449 as my critical value. If I had put in 0.02, it would have been negative. I just remember, oh, I need to make it positive. So using the critical value method, I compare my test statistic to my critical value. Is it less than my critical value in this fail to reject region, or is it greater than my critical value in the rejection region? 1.788 is less than 2.499, so my test statistic is down here. Okay, I'll just indicate that with a little T star. So this is consistent with the decision I got when I used the p-value method. Whatever method you use, the p-value method or the critical value method, you will get the same conclusion. The critical value method compares values along this horizontal axis. The p-value method compares areas. So the p-value in this case is the area further to the right of my standardized test statistic. Having a little bit of trouble with my red pen. So this p-value is going to be this area further to the right of 1.788. It's clearly a larger area than 0.02. It's covering this, and it's in the fail to reject region. Okay, so again, you're going to get the same conclusion whether or not you use the p-value method or the critical value method. So again, there is not enough evidence, or there is insufficient evidence to support the claim that the SAT prep course increases scores on average more than 60 points. And because the decision was to fail to reject the null, it is possible that a type 2 error may have occurred.